any understanding of this nation has to be based, and I mean really based, on an understanding of the Civil War. I believe that firmly defined us.
When
the
revolution
is
not on the battlefield, it's really not about weapons, it's not about soldiers, except to the extent that weapons and soldiers, at that crucial moment, join the discussion about something higher, about humanity, about human dignity, about human freedom. If there was a single event that caused it was the establishment of the United States in independence from Great Britain, with slavery still a part of its heritage.
When he got out of range, he threw the man off and rode back to Jones.
They had 30% in several.
That was the last shot fired in the battle.
And one after another, you see.
It could have been a very ugly, filthy war with no redeeming characteristics at all.
He would never mail a letter that would be in transit.
The battle for emancipation and the people who pushed it forward, the slaves, the free black people, the abolitionists, and a lot of ordinary citizens, it was they who ennobled what otherwise would have been meaningless carnage into something higher.
And Jackson looked around for him, he wasn't there.
The slaves understood that that war was about slavery before it was a war.
Very commendable, very commendable.
They made a nuissance for the army, and they also made an issue that the army had to deal with. And if the army had to deal with it, the War Department had to deal with it. If the War Department had to deal with it, Congress had to deal with it. That means that every fugitive slave who made a nuisance of himself to the local commander eventually made a figure of himself to the Congress of the United States. I lose patience with the argument that because of someone's time, his limitations are therefore excusable or even praiseworthy. It is not true that it was impossible in that time and place to look any higher. Think of Wendell Phillips, who, commenting on Abraham Lincoln's proposal to colonize black people out of the country, was sarcastic. He said, "Colonize the blacks? A man might as well colonize his own hands, or when the robber is in his house, he might as well colonize his revolver." It's hard to separate one issue from another. Obviously, Lincoln had to win the war. He had to keep his respectability as president of a country that would not allow itself to be defeated by a group of rebels. So that was always an issue, and it was especially an issue, of course, in 1862. He could not let himself be made a fool and the Union be made a fool by standing up for principles that could not be vindicated on the battlefield.
Like in the cornfield at Sharpsburg, and the news may be that there are no more young men in that town. They're all dead. Jackson was sitting on his horse eating a peach, and his medical director, Dr. McGuire, was there. And he looked out over this field where they were dead of both sides, littered all over the place. And as he's eating a peach, he said, "God has been very kind to us this day."
Affected by the Emancipation Proclamation, obviously did not receive it as news, because they knew before Lincoln knew that the war was about emancipation. And moreover, they knew, as perhaps Lincoln did without fully realizing it, and certainly as many people today do not realize, that the Emancipation Proclamation did nothing to get them their freedom. It said that they had a right to go and put their bodies on the line if they had the nerve to believe in it. And many of them had the nerve to believe in it. And many suffered for that.
It can't be done except at Iran. And I couldn't do it anyhow with a mouth full of false teeth and a stomach full of food. So they never get to hear what it sounded like.
When a black soldier in New Orleans said, "Liberty must take the day, nothing shorter," he said, in effect, that when we count up those who have died, when we survey the carnage, it must be for something higher than union and free navigation of the Mississippi River. During the summer of 1863, a convention of free black people demanded the right for black men to take part in the struggle as soldiers. And their key resolution said, "It is time now for more effective remedies to be thoroughly tried in the shape of warm lead and cold steel, duly administered by 100,000 black doctors." Many of the Union soldiers who began with stereotypical assumptions about black men, who assumed that they couldn't fight, that they would hand their weapons over to the enemy, that they would run, and so on, had their minds changed in the grimmest circumstances. And some of the documents that tell the story of how people's ideas were transformed are not the sort of documents that you enjoy reading, because they speak of how people became companions in death, of how white soldiers learned to respect their black comrades when they watched how they reacted as people all around were being killed, being butchered.
He can go back to the time before the war was going to be lost, doesn't come off it. And he can always have that moment for himself. He knew what Grant was going to do because he can make himself Grant would do it. Kept talking about Bobby Lee. Bobby Lee. Grant finally told him, "I'm tired of hearing about Bobby Lee. Think he's going to do a double somersault and land on our rear. Quit thinking about what he's going to do. Making it as he's going to tell the history in the camp." They were so much larger than Grant. They never got anyone he didn't understand. But what division was that? But they had some fierce things the first time they were going to combat. They'd have a mangled corpse artillery shot by the side of the road with blankets. And as the new green regiments came abreast, they whisked the blanket off and said, "This is what's waiting for you up ahead." Not a very pleasant story. He was immortalized during the war. Can you imagine being brought before General Lee for having broken his leg? And the young man was trembling. And Lee said, "You need not be afraid. You'll get justice here." And the young man said, "I know it, General. That's what I'm scared of."
Bedford Forrest in battle.
The most man in the world in some ways.
Forrest was a natural genius. Someone said that he was born to be a soldier the way John Keats was born to be a poet.
In the spring of 64,
he had some basic principles. When you translate them, they fit right into the Army manual. When he said,
"Quit there first, Joe, boys."
And then they got out to a
line of foam.
She said, "Well, you know, in our family, we never thought much of Mr. Lincoln." She didn't like my cup of her grandfather with Abraham Lincoln all these years. Southerners was very strange about their family.
And he was able to look at a great tragedy. Brown and see how
you know what the outside and the blockade was living. They couldn't get very simple things like needles to sew with, very simple things. And the discouragement began to settle in more and more with the realization that they were not going to win that war. Their political leaders did everything they could, especially Jefferson Davis, to assure them that this was the second American Revolution, and if they would stand fast the way their forefathers had, the victory was unquestionably going to come. But the realization came more and more that it was not going to come, especially that they were not going to get foreign recognition, without which we wouldn't have won the first revolution. And all those things closed in on.
He saw,
as a
Southerner,
I would say,
how hard a war was
going
to be. And when he set out how hard a war was going to be,
Southerners have
he
a
was
sense
retired under
of
suspicion
defeat,
of insanity,
which
and then brought
the
back when they decided
has,
maybe he wasn't so crazy after
you
all.
You see in the movie Patton, the
Sherman
actor
is
Patton saying,
maybe
"We
the first
have never
truly
lost
modern
war.
General."
It's rather
the first
amazing
one
to understand to make as Patton, because Patton's grandfather was in Lee's Army of Northern Virginia.
Civilians were the
and
backers up
lost
of things, and that if you went against civilians, you deprived the Army of what kept it going, so he quite purposely made war against civilians.
Before
the war,
the it
was said the United
in
States
history in that
was spoken that way and thought of
it is the moment that made the United
States.
States as a nation.
And after the war, it was
and I mean that in different
States
ways.
Is,
the United States was obviously a nation when it adopted a constitution.
And that sums up what the
but
war
it adopted
accomplished.
A constitution that required a war,
when the war was
to be
over,
sorted out,
on both sides, they knew they
and therefore
country.
Required a war
they
to make a real nation out of what was
roads,
a theoretical nation
they
as,
saw the country.
As it was designed at the Constitutional Convention.
And they knew the effort
who won
that
the
they
war?
Had and their dead friends
the Union Army obviously
it.
Won the war in
it
the sense that they were the army left standing and holding their
actuality.
Weapons when it was all over.
These misconceptions about Davis are so strange that it's as if
so
a gigantic
so the soldiers who fought in the Union Army,
lost.
The generals who directed it, the president
by
who led the country
who having lost the war
it,
did not want to
blame
it on the generals, so they blamed it on the politicians.
If we're not
of
talking
Davis
just about the series of battles
so it was
that finished up with the surrender at Appomattox, but talking instead
the
about
hanging
the
from
struggle
the
to make something
apple tree, but, the
higher
really
and better out of the country. Then the
he
question
ended up in
gets more complicated.
Way you might
the slaves
have expected
won the war and they lost
to expect
the war
it.
Because they
he
won
was,
freedom.
Didn't know what to do with himself
that
after
is,
the war. His profession
the removal
was
of
gone.
Slavery.
Even his country
but they did
was
not
gone.
Win freedom as they
and
understood
he was approached
freedom.
With a good deal of hesitation by these
I
people from
what
a little
we
school
need
called
to
Washington College.
Most of all, is
and
that
he accepted the presidency
Civil
of Washington
war
College
is
an
not
annual
over
salary of $1,500
until
and
we
a house to live
today.
In.
And have done our part
life
in fighting
what after his death was
as well as
Washington
understanding
Lee.
What happened
he will smile
when the Civil War
and give you with
generation
unflinching
fought
courtesy, prayers,
William
trappings,
Faulkner
letters, uniforms
said
and
once
orders,
that
photographs, kindness,
history is not
valor and advice,
was, it's
and do it
is.
With such grace and gentleness.
And what we need to remember
you
about the Civil War is that
down,
the Civil
out,
War is
easy to understand.
In the present as
and
well
so
as in
have.
The past. The generation that fought the war, the generation that argued over
the
definition of the war,
the
generation that had to pay the price in blood, that had to pay the price in blasted hopes and a lost future.
Superior people.
Also established a standard that will not mean anything until we have finished the war.
We have to make it the greatest war of all time.
There's no such thing as slavery anymore. We're all citizens. But if we're all citizens, then we have a task to do to make sure that that too is not a joke. If some citizens live in houses and others live on the street, the Civil War is still going on. It's still to be fought, and regrettably, it can still be lost.
18 and served through Appomattox. Saw it so when he got around to composing the reminiscences he hoped would go down amongst my descendants for a long time. Reliving the war in words, he began to wish he could relive it in fact. And he came to believe that he and his fellow soldiers, gray and blue, might one day be able to do just that, if not here on Earth, then afterwards in Valhalla. Who knows, he asked as his narrative drew toward its close, but it may be given to us after this life to meet again in the old quarters, to play chess and drafts, to get up soon to answer the morning roll call, to fall in at the tap of the drum for drill and dress parade, and again to hastily don our war gear while the monotonous patter of the long roll summons to battle. Who knows, but again the old flags, ragged and torn, snapping in the wind, may face each other and flutter, pursuing and pursued, while the cries of victory fill a summer day. And after the battle, then the slain and wounded will arise, and all will meet together under the two flags, all sound and well, and there will be talking and laughter and cheers, and all will say, did it not seem real? Was it not as in the old days?